Greetings, fellow nerds. It's time for the November question and answer video. Now, before we start, I have a few things to discuss. First, I'm sorry for being rather slow this month. I recently got addicted to Fallout 4, and I'm desperately trying to break that addiction. I'll let you know if I succeed. Second, I recently posted a video about making chloroform, and looking at the comments, most people think I'm making it for illicit purposes. Chloroform cannot actually be used for drugging people because it's very slow acting. It takes a few minutes of constant deep inhaling for it to work. More than enough time for them to fight you. The way chloroform is depicted in movies, books, and other works of fiction is blatantly wrong. Now, I'm making chloroform because it's one of the necessary precursors for my long series on making the antiprotozoan and AIDS treatment pyrimethamine, also known as Daraprim. I am not using it to drug and kidnap people. Those days are behind me. Now, this month I want to give big shoutouts to four new big sponsors on Patreon. Only HR, David Smith, James Nicole, and Michelle Alanazzi. Thank you very much for your contributions. So let's get to the questions, and it looks they're only four this time, which is great for me because then I can get back to making videos sooner. Yeah, making videos. Okay, Keith asks, why do tapes and glue stick to metals, some plastics, but not polytetrafluoroethylene? There are many different mechanisms by which adhesives work. Some stick using van der Waals forces, others interlock with the surface. Some actually dissolve the surface slightly and then re-solidify. Others chemically react with the surface and bond to it that way. And there are even more mechanisms that I won't get into, but most general adhesives use multiple mechanisms to bond to a surface. The thing about polytetrafluoroethylene, also known as Teflon or PTFE, is that very few of those mechanisms actually work. It dissolves in almost nothing, it's very smooth and non-porous, so interlocking with it is hard. It is chemically inert, so reactions don't work on it, and so on. Therefore, very few things will stick to such a surface. Alrighty, Jason Black asks, are there any chemical reactions that are affected by electromagnetic fields? Chemistry is pretty much all about the electrons, and magnetism is a quantum phenomenon involving electron spin, so I have to wonder. Actually, yes. In fact, it's actually a rather large field of study. I, however, know very little about it, and thus I don't feel comfortable explaining how it works, but I have linked in the video description some interesting papers that review the subject. Bottom line is that certain reactions that proceed by radical mechanisms are strongly influenced by magnetic fields, because the fields change how the distribution of singlet and triplet states of the molecules evolve. Beyond that though, the math goes right over my head, so you'll have to check out those papers for yourself. Colin Wright asks, could you please explain the industrial process for creating pure aluminum metal, and if you know of any way of refining it cheaper or more environmentally friendly on that scale? It's somewhat interesting to me as my professor once explained it to take up 10% of America's electricity to achieve the high temperatures associated with the reactions. Okay, the process for making aluminum is pretty much textbook chemistry. The primary ore of aluminum is aluminum oxide. Now this melts at 2000 degrees Celsius, and since lower temperature is cheaper and easier to work with, it's dissolved in sodium hexafluoroaluminate. This mixture melts at around 1000 degrees Celsius. Now the molten mixture is placed in a large metal container, usually iron, and huge graphite electrodes are inserted. A negative potential is applied to the conductive metal container, and a positive potential is applied to the graphite electrodes. The aluminum oxide dissolved in the sodium hexafluoroaluminate is electrolyzed into aluminum metal and oxygen. Now, the oxygen at these temperatures is extremely corrosive and burns the graphite electrodes into carbon dioxide, which constantly have to be replaced. The aluminum deposits on the metal container walls, and since aluminum melts at 660 Celsius, it actually deposits a liquid at these temperatures and pools in the bottom of the container where it's tapped off. A lot of power is used for both heating and electrolyzing this reaction. I personally do not know of any cheaper way of doing it. If I did, I'd be disgustingly rich and I probably wouldn't be begging for money through Patreon. Which, by the way, is still going and I'm still begging with links in the video description. Okay, moving on. ChaosR1024 asks, acetone peroxide, TATP or Mother of Satan in the media, has been implicated as used in the Paris bombings and one of the easiest to produce household chemical based bombs. It is also the reason why access to acetone and hydrogen peroxide has been severely limited for civilians in many countries, including mine. Do you think it is effective to limit access to household chemicals in their raw form to prevent the creation of bombs by terrorists? Or are there plenty of other ways using readily available products? And on a more philosophical level, do you think we should?
Okay, well, there are far too many ways to make bombs from household materials. I don't think it would be very effective to limit a few chemicals as individuals with nefarious intentions will just move on to other chemicals. Now, I don't have a good philosophical answer. I am neither good enough nor wise enough to make that assessment. Personally, I don't really care. I can make anything from anything else as long as it has the same elements. Just the number of steps in between will vary. So ban everything you want. It might slow me down, but it certainly won't stop me. The big problem, though, is that the terrorists won't be stopped either. Okay, next question. Charlie Piliote asks, would you sell a service to test food for lead and arsenic contamination, or does that require really expensive equipment due to the minute quantities involved? I won't be doing it. When trusting an analytical test for your food, it better be a good, accurate, and reliable test with exit detection limits. Quality equipment and resources to perform such a test is not cheap. I'd need to run and bill for thousands of tests to justify the purchase of such equipment. If you really want your food tested, look up analytical testing laboratories in your area. Okay, so that's it for this month. Hopefully I'll break my Fallout 4 addiction and get back to making videos soon. I hope. Eventually.